Now look here, Everett.
I'm not Everett. That's Everett over there.
Is he doing new series for us?
Yes, sir.
Why in God's name did we agree to that?
There was no one else, sir.
Well, there must be something we can do. Is there time to cancel?
I'm afraid not. The show's about to start.
What? Now?
Yes, sir.
Oh, my God, turn on the television set. We must watch this show very carefully and make sure there's nothing funny going on.
It's the Kenny Everett television show, starring Kenny Everett.
Sorry about that, sir. Just had to do the opening.
Well, get on with it.
Here's the first sketch.
Would you like a sweet, sir?
Yes, I think I really would. How about a number 19, darling? Yes, a number 19, please.
One number 19, please.
It's really wonderful. Is that your first sketch?
Yes, sir.
Oh, my God.
For a break, so let's break.
Hello, Snotrigs. It's me, Sid. Who else? Any road up.
Here's a story with an ecclesiastical overtone. There were these three geezers playing cards on a train. A priest, a rabbi, and a vicar. And they were playing for money, know what I mean? Suddenly, the fuzz appears of the British Rail variety. Next thing you know, they're all in court. The judge says to the priest, "You are charged with gambling in a public place. How'd you plead?" Police looks up to heaven and says, "Sotto voce." "One white lie, Father. Just one white lie." And says, "Not guilty." "Case dismissed," says the beak. Says to the vicar, "You are charged with gambling in a public place. How do you plead?" Vicar looks up to heaven and says, "Just one white lie, Father. Just one." Looks at the judge and says, "Not guilty." "Case dismissed," says the beak. Then he turns to the rabbi. "You are charged with gambling in a public place." And the rabbi says, "Who with?"
Now, ladies and gentlemen, we have the world's greatest escapologist or escape artist. Those of you watching in black and white.
Good evening, Damen und Herren. I am the great Escapo, and this is my beautiful assistant, Ingeborg. As you can see, I am already inside the straitjacket, and the chains surround my body, which Ingeborg is currently, at this moment in time, padlocking. After which, she will place me in the concrete mixer, where I will be ground into tiny fragments. After which, she will pour me into this meat-mincing thing, where I will be totally minced into mince. After which, she will pour me into the liquidizer, where I will be totally liquidized. After which, she will pour the liquid me into this wine glass, which she will drink. after which I will escape. As you can see, I am now in the concrete mixer, switch on in the bag. Quite nice in here, really. Not much pain at all. And now the bucket will come out, the special sequin bucket, into which I am about to be poured. Okay, Ingeborg, now! I think I've broken my contact lens. Put my thank you, Ingeborg. Oh, over to the Mensa. Okay. Into the Mensa! Thank you, Ingeborg! Oh, I messed up my foot. Oh, never mind. Okay, Ingi. Switch off. And now I am totally liquid. Pour me into the wine glass, please. Thank you. Oh, clumsy woman. Okay, now drink me out. Danke. Where am I?
I thought the age of the casting couch was over.
No, I think it's me. Yes.
Good morning.
Good morning.
You know what this picture's about, do you?
Well, no, actually. My agent just said to come along.
Oh, look, we're making a horror movie here, and I don't think you're quite right for it, I'm afraid.
Oh, no, horror's my speciality. My big thing is frightening. Moyer.
Mr. Moyer, look here, this is a film with special effects. There'll be a lot of frightening things going on here. What we really want is some bizarre people. Frankly, I don't know why your agent sent you here.
Well, there is one frightening thing I do.
Oh, what's that?
My head blows up. It's very effective. Do you want to see it?
Oh, yes, I would.
Okay, now?
Yes, now.
Right.
Fantastic! How did you do that? That was wonderful! We're going to be rich! Rich! Rich!
It's the first time I've done it, and I didn't like it much.
Let this show go okay, with no major boobs or goofs, and without accidentally saying a rude word like knickers or bum. By the way, are you listening?
No, I'm watching ITV.
Thank you very much.
But I'm taping you.
DG, that means it's the Director General's office. He's the head of everything. Oh, so exciting. Let's have a look, shall we?
Good morning, Mr. Everett. Welcome to the BBC.
Naughty DG. Let's have a look at something else. Look, it's all initials. OBOPS, that's Outside Broadcast Operators, Productions, Assistant Engineering, MY. What's that? Hang on. M.Y. Oh, Mike Yarwood. And this one, BUM, that must be Broadcasting Under Manager. No, it's a bum. What else is up here? Toadies, studios, and,
Ken!
You!
Well met!
At moonlight!
Let us continue as we did last night.
Darling!
You're dancing as well as ever.
I know.
But now I must away.
Why?
I must see the Broadcasting Under Manager.
No!
Oh, yes!
Terry!
No, no, I must do it,
Ken!
Don't
open that door!
Not bad. Not bad. Not bad.
That sketch was not too bad.
Yeah.
Here's your host for the Dinosaur Pizza Challenge. Dinosaur Pizza Challenge. And just a reminder of the rules, all our contestants have to do is come on and talk to me for just 2 minutes without mentioning any large extinct land reptiles of the late Mesozoic era or any mouth-watering deep dish pizzas currently available from bona fide outlets. So, can we have our first person right along here, please, who wants to play the Dinosaur Pizza Challenge? Tell the lovely audience what your lovely name is.
Albert.
Albert, that's a lovely name, isn't it, audience? Albert what?
Brontosaurus.
Oh!
Here comes the patter. It don't make sense, but it don't matter. I'll spew out words in a great long stream and whip your little brains to cream. It's a wrap. Okay, plebs, you got the gist? Or are you all too bronze and list? Pay attention, sit up straight. Oh, forget it, I can't wait. It's a wrap.
Trouble parking, just can't find a place to leave that car. Tired of driving round and round the block looking for a parking space that's never there? Well, why not get rid of that outmoded form of transport that you use, or as you call it, a car, and move into the 80s with the new improved Sherman tank. Yes, with a Sherman tank, your parking problems are over. Because with a Sherman tank, you can park in a space that's already taken by another car. Yes, get yourself a Sherman tank. You know it makes sense.
Have you noticed that TV shows today are leaning more and more towards sexual innuendo? I think it's absolutely disgusting that this sort of thing is allowed, particularly here at the BBC. It seems that every time you turn on the telly, some low comedian is using some bosomy girl as a foil for his cheap jokes. If you agree, write to me. Ludovic Kennedy, keep boobs off our tubes, Wood Lane, London, etc. Thank you for watching tonight. As you can see, I'm standing here in a living room set. And why not? It's a family show, and that's what families are all about. Living rooms. And I'm sure you're pleased to see that we've got some scantily clad, buxom young ladies dusting and hoovering around the room as a ploy to show most of their bodily particles. Yes, we know what family shows are all about. We know what you really want to see. I mean, why should we stay up all night trying to think of sketches where we squeeze in a girl with hardly anything on? We thought, why not just get them out here right away? This is showbiz. Why not show it? Now we're going to see some lovely sketches. But don't worry, you'll be seeing more of the girls later.
Excuse me, handsome lifeguard.
What is it, voluptuous swimmer?
There's a man eating fish in the water.
Seems to be the trouble.
Someone's just held up the delicatessen. They've stolen bagels, matzahs, salt beef strudel, and 10 gallons of lokshen soup.
Hmm, sounds like a job for the flying rabbi.
Yes, where is he?
Oh,
there you are. Someone's just held up the delicatessen.
Oh, no.
Hello, DIY buffs. Reg Prescott here with some more helpful DIY tips for all DIY freaks out there in DIY land. Well, you'll let us keep rolling in, and as you can see, I've got them stacked in this handy mail rack that we made last week for a staggering total of £1.87. This one... from Derek Hollingsworth of Ward 3, the Middlesex Hospital, and he says, "Dear Reg, more power to your DIY elbow. Unfortunately, I had a little disagreement with my electric saw while constructing my mail rack. But not to worry, I'll be back in DIY harness by the time you get this. In fact, they say I'll have to wear this harness for a while yet. Say, Labby, yours DIY-ly, Derek Hollingsworth." Right on, Derek. Just before we start, I'd like to say a few words about looking after your tools. A dirty tool is no use to anybody. They've got to be in the right place and clean and sharp. Like our old mate, the crosscut saw. He likes to live down here. And I've really had a go at sharpening him today.
Sorry about that, Kevin.
Come after the saw?
Yes, please.
Because it seemed all right up to there. Hello. Hello. Well, now to business. Let's get on with our French provincial Louis XIV cabinet, or cabinet, as they say in the Belle France. You'll remember, we started the cabinet, and we've completed the frame. This week, we'll be doing the doors. And for this, we'll be using our trusty old chum, the electric jigsaw, down here.
Hold it! Hold it!
I was holding it. Okay. Advise you never to leave electric tools plugged in on the bench, else you might have a really nasty accident. Right, this little rascal here can be a very handy friend around the workshop. It'll save us a lot of time making our cabinet francaise. With this all-purpose blade, which is sharp enough to cut through anything. Let's get a door part, shall we? Let's call this door here number one. And this door over here, we'll call number two. As you can see, I've marked out the shape, and we'll be cutting. And we'll be cutting. Right. Here. I will put the cutter on the edge here, right? Here, we'll grab the wood with this hand. And we'll start off by cutting down the line, making sure we have the wood nice and steady. Well, here we are then. Le cabinet est fini. It's a piece of cake and takes no time at all. I'd like to hear from you about how you got on. You know, there's lots of room in these drawers for... Kevin, are these my fingers? Well, that's it for now, DIY fans. See you next week.
The other way! Oh.
And don't forget to keep the workshop tidy. Thank you.
It's not here. Rock and roll will never die. Say I'm wrong and I'll spit in your eye. Here. Funny the things you see in a great metropolis like our beloved London here. Only yesterday, I was on this bus and suddenly, before my disbelieving eyeballs, this old joke came to life. The bus broke down. Driver gets out, whips up the bonnet and starts looking inside. We are sitting there, 10 minutes, and a conductress gets out and says to him, "Do you want a screwdriver?" He says, "Leave it out, we're 10 minutes late already."
Are you reading, Grace?
Oh, Agnes!
I was just reading here in the paper about a man who's been arrested.
Oh, dear.
Oh, it seems he was a gardener at a convent school.
My word.
And apparently he was enticing young girls to go back to his lodgings. And in return for having his way, he'd take them to films and restaurants, buy them new clothes. One of them even got a moped.
It was all very different in her day, dear.
Yes, all we ever got was a bag of sweets.
If I may say with no modesty, I've been very successful at it. I've got four films in production at the moment, Death Wish 3, Death Wish 4, Death Wish 5, and Death Wish 6, and then we're planning a sequel. Now, this particular project, when it came to me, I'm going to appear in myself, and there's only one person I wanted to have with me, because I've watched your career very closely. You have a wonderful screen presence, real charisma, you act with the eyes, which is so important in movies, and you know, for any artist to be in a Michael Winner film can only boost their career, and I really want you to do it.
Well, Michael, believe me, I really want to do it with you. It's just a question of whether the script is right. You wouldn't believe what some people try to get me to do. I'm always finding myself in the strangest position. I'm sure you're not one of them, are you?
Certainly.
Mm. After all, you direct Charles Bronson. I love him. He's so beefy and meaty and chunky.
Well, you make him sound like a stew.
Tell me, this film you want me to star in, what's it all about?
Well, I like to think it has really a very great sociological importance.
Really?
Yes, it's about the misfits of our society, the people who can't adapt to the 20th century, the flotsam and jetsam.
Oh, what's it called?
It's called Bloodbath in Cell Block 11.
Oh, a catchy title. What do I play?
Well, we'd like you to play the part of a nun.
Again? Isn't typecasting terrible? Did you see me in Dirty Habits? I played this Mother Superior with a difference. She's a real mother, and she goes berserk when she finds out the abbot is really a werewolf. In fact, that was the first thing I did for Disney. I'm doing another one for them. It's called Herbie Slashes His Wrists. Your little film, Michael.
When the riot breaks out, the prisoners take you hostage and they hold you in the laundry, and you're completely naked.
I'm naked?
Well, it's quite warm in the laundry.
Oh, I get it. Do I?
Well, you do get it. So you're not really a nun. You're the chief warder.
Oh, you mean the top screw. To say in this country. You know, Michael, I'm really up to this part. What do you play?
I play the good prison officer.
Oh, you're a good screw. I've heard that. Michael, just know we're gonna get on great together.
I can see it now. You and I, together in the cell block. And all the men are banging on the bars. And I say, stop doing that. And you pick up your big hose. And I turn you on. And then the water hits me. And all my clothes fall off again. Oh, it's so sociological. But I tell you one thing, Michael, I'm going to have to insist on.
What's that?
It's got to be done in the best possible taste.
Yeah, I found out why they call it strained food.
Wasn't that a great sketch? I think the show's wonderful, don't you? Oh, I say. I've dropped my flower.
Shall I pick it up for you?
What a good idea. Wasn't that just great? Let's see it again in slow motion.
Oh, dear. I dropped my flower.
Shall I pick it up for you?
What a good idea.
Don't get too close to the set. It steams up the camera. Oh, there's some more sketches coming up. But don't worry, we'll be back soon.
Brothers and sisters, we are gathered here today. Brothers and sisters, when the tangled threads of life get knotted, you gotta stand up and you gotta hold your own.
Hold your own.
Love is all around you, so reach out and touch it.
Reach out and touch it.
And if that devil puts you on the road to hell, get off.
Get off.
I hear you, brothers and sisters.
It is me putting my clock again for you. You know, I get so many letters from you out there in Plebland, and the message is always the same. Dear Marcel, video sex symbol, I need you. I want to make love to you. Well, I'm afraid you can't. After all, you don't put high octane in a mini minor or Dom Perignon in a Coke bottle. But I tell you what you do. The next time you are with your husband, close your eyes and think of me. And wherever I am, I'll be thinking of me too.
Jim Strange, and I say rude things, really rude, I mean not just rude, but rude, and it's one of those very rude words rumbling up inside me now. I can feel it coming at all these particles, and here it comes, a rude word. Belly button. Wee wee. Too rude for you, eh? Can't take it, eh? Armpits. Bogies. Give
hazel hair.
And my pest resistance. Blackheads!
You're disgusting.
Oh no, sweaty feet. Dirty fingernails. I won't be censored like this. I like that character. He was specially created to get instant smut into the show. He blew him up! After all, what's a Kenny Everett show without smut? Right, just for that, I'm gonna tell the joke about the transvestite and the alligator. It all happened one night in a gay bar in Uganda.
Here, fancy a bit.
Okay. I'll have this bit.
This show is not too bad. We liked a sketch or two. But now it's time for something else. We just can't wait, can you?
Don't answer that.
Oh, kiss of puke. My life just perish. Here's a joke. This real pub dads 24 pints of lager and eats 18 packets of peanuts. Didn't bother him a bit. By Joe, on the way home, he pebble-dashed 2 houses.
Hello, I'm Barbara Cartland. And you're all under arrest. I'd like to read you an extract from my new romantic novel. When Lady Penelope swoons, her bosoms pop out like balloons. Her butler stands by with a gleam in his eye and pops them back in with warm spoons.
Answer it, you fool!
Later that afternoon... What? I'll get over right away. Book me a flight. Book me a plane. Buy me an airline. No pickle on the sandwiches this time.
Who was that?
Oh, that, my dear, was Dwayne El Rashid, international arms dealer and Saudi billionaire.
What did he want?
I don't know. The pips went.
I sometimes think your pips went years ago.
Kiss me, Texas.
I love you, Burke.
Yes, I know.
Hearing, that's the worst part.
I didn't know you was deaf.
Pardon? Yeah, what? Is he dead? Well, ask him. Not. Yep. But why? Who knows? But this means I'm in control. You bastard. Talk.
Spam. RJ, I've got some news.
Yes?
There was heavy snow in Baltimore earlier today, but it's expected to clear later. And?
Yeah?
There's been an accident! Burke!
Burke!
Burke?
He was driving on Highway 37 when a tree jumped out in front of him.
Oh, God! I'm not hearing this.
He was on Highway 37 when a tree...
All they found... was this?
Here, I saw this little bit of graffiti on the clinic wall the other day. What's pink and wrinkly and hangs out your trousers? Your mum.
To the toilet instead of waiting till the head first. You'll do yourself damage.
Oh, it's no good. I've got to go into the kitchen and change it to something horrible.
What is it, darling? Can I help in any way?
Don't come in when I'm changing. Oh, it's agony. Now I know what a tadpole feels like. The pain. I'm so brave. So brave.
Do you think it was something in the casserole, love?
Oh, no. I'm changing it into a fly.
Oh, darling. How horrible. How can we possibly live together with you as a giant fly?
We'll just have to adjust, darling.
Twinkle again here, meandering around the highways and byways of Britain, winkling my way in and out of your nooks and crannies, and looking up old friends with the aid of a periscope. And this week, I'm in the sleepy Sussex village of Rigor Mortis, on the outskirts of Harry Secombe, where local residents are especially warm and glowing due to an horrific gas explosion in the high street. And none of these wonderful people has touched my bosom quite so much as old Maisie Quincy, the village blacksmith, who, although completely bedridden since the milkman came round, and although under threat of demolition by the local council, who want to knock her down with a wrecking ball to make way for Samantha Fox, still manages to remain constantly miserable and hideously depressed. So for Maisie, and for all people who, for one reason or another, have just had a close relative staked out on an anthill due to a Home Office computer error, here is Alec Jones to sing, "Oh, for the Wings of a Dove." Oh, by the way, since the last series, thousands of you have written in to say how deeply upset you were to see your favorite singers being put through a mincing machine, which you found sickening, cruel, and unpleasantly violent. So this time, we're going to do this. Until I come up your way next week. Bye-bye, everyone.
I love you, Sam.
I know that, kid.
Oh, I'd do anything for you.
I know that, kid.
Who's that?
I know that kid.
Yeah, but we're on the 14th floor.
So he's tall. Give me a slug. And a drink.
Doctor, your next patient is here.
Okay, so wheel him in. Okay, Chuchi, what's your problem?
You sure you're a doctor?
Of course I'm a doctor. Sam Spade, private eye and doctor. $100 a day expenses, no questions asked.
Can you help me?
No questions, okay?
Yes, I want you to help me.
Okay, what's the problem?
I have this kidney complaint.
My God, you're right.
That's not mine, that's yours.
This is mine? Oh, my God, I'm in big trouble here.
No, that's your drink.
Oh, good, I thought I was dying.
Oh, stop making a specimen of yourself.
Why did you say that?
Just in case I didn't get the joke.
Shut up. Look, you're ill. Take your clothes off. Not you, stupid, her.
I want a second opinion.
I agree, take your clothes off.
Okay, Noodle Pie. Here's your prescription.
Thank you, Doctor.
But it says go behind the screen for 10 minutes. I don't get it.
Wanna bet?
Oh, thank you, Doctor. I feel much better.
Take that 3 times a day after meals, kid, okay?
I will.
And remember.
Yes, Doctor.
Shake well before using.
Is that the end of the sketch?
I said no questions.
So
get out of here.
Yes, Doctor.
Well, good night, sweethearts. See you in the morning.
My mummy says that I could grow up to be just like my dad. I said, does that mean I've got to sleep with the woman next door?
Your shoulders and the rest is bare, but I love records and big hips. Sydney, get your hand off my... Listen, Slaggy, you're doing it wrong. You gotta stay on the beat to do this song.
Oh, Sydney, I'd really love to do it.
I'll leave it out. There's nothing to it. It's a rap.
Through this afternoon if I'm going to show you the ropes.
I'm moving as fast as I can.
Well, it's not fast enough. You'll have to book your ideas up if you're going to make the grade at Mapping. I didn't get where I am today by not booking up.
Well, it's all right for you. You're a yellow coat.
Oh, 10 out of 10 for observation. Get back in the knife box. You're too sharp to live. Now, see. When you do a shally, it's bed, strip, change.
You are?
Strip, change. The bed's a great dishcloth. Change the sheets, put the mucky ones in the basket and lay the new ones. Now, ashtrays, litter bin, empty. Have you got it?
I think so.
Well, say it back to me then.
I strip and change and then I get it made.
Sounds suggestive. Carry on.
I've forgotten.
Ashtrays, litter bin, empty.
Ashtrays, litter bin, empty.
Sink.
Sink.
Towels, check soap and remove personal items.
Towels, check soap and remove personal items. What do you mean by personal items?
Old razor blades, eyebrow pencils, stuff like that.
Old razor blades, eyebrow pencils, stuff like that.
Why me? Then when you've done the bedroom and the sink a quick dust round, don't forget, every weekend when they go home, we hoover. But check the controls. I don't want you blowing when you should be sucking. Suck, don't blow.
Suck, don't blow. Got it. It's ever so kind you to help me like this.
Oh, think nothing of it. I was out by the other girls when I started. Not by Miss Cathcart, though. Watch out for her. If she was in India, she'd be sacred.
Does she come from India, then?
You'll like Spike. He's the one who dresses up. And Ted the comic's all right, but keep your hand on your holiday money.
Yeah, I've met that Gladys.
Oh, we call her Mr. Fairbrother's Welsh rabbit. But don't hate me. She's all right, underneath.
Yeah,
How long have you been the other coat?
Well, I'm fairly new. It was only the other week. Not before time. It took him long enough to spot my potential.
What do you think I'll ever make a yellow coat?
Well, play your cards right and keep your nose clean. There's just one more thing. I don't quite know how to put it, but you've got a little personal problem, haven't you?
What do you mean?
You've got a beard.
Well, I'm a man.
Oh, I see. Come on, Stevie.
Profession, don't they? And with me coming from a broken home and that, I suppose I just sort of slipped into it naturally.
Well, I understand. Far be it from me to point a finger. You know what they say, don't you? Let him who is without sin cast the first stone.
Do you mean like in slimming?
What?
Well, you said cast the first stone and that's losing weight,
isn't it? No, not stone, like 14 pounds of that. Anyway, it's all metric now, isn't it?
That's right. So it would be, let him who is without sin cast the first 6.3503 kilograms.
No, that's weight, that is. I'm talking about your actual stones, you know. Because in the old days, right, sinners used to get stoned.
Well, they still do. Stick it up their nose.
Stick it up their nose? No, look, let's start. Try this. Be sure your sins will find you out.
Find me out? Not anymore. I've got this machine which takes all my calls when I'm out.
And now, this.
Treacle here once again, spreading love where there's hatred, hope where there's despair, and ointment where there's piles. You know, in this troubled life, we all of us lead. There are many, many of us who still yearn after that ultimate meaning. Many of us who feel somehow incomplete as human beings due to a horrific accident with a 25-kilowatt chainsaw. From Mr. Chubby Thropefoot of Rabies Terrace in the fashionable part of Peckham. He writes, "Dear Verity, I am 46 years old and suffer from dandruff the size of golf balls. I also suffer from golf balls, which I gather is related to tennis elbow. Due to genetic mutations, I have the head of a pelican and only one leg, which is made of solid mahogany. My sex life is nothing to write home about, so I've stopped writing home about it. Chubby, I know it's all too easy for you to feel rejected, outcast, and unwanted, because you are. But I'm sure you'll be comforted, as I was, by this beautiful rendition of Verdi's Requiem, played this week by someone new to the mincing machine, Miss Mary O'Hara.
Liber scriptus proferre.
Welcome to another edition of Through the Eero, in which we explore the bodies of famous celebrities. This week, we're taking a look down the lughole of the Queen of Soaps, Joan Collins. Now, we've got to go in through this ear, as the other one has got a tongue in it. It wouldn't be so bad, but it's hers. How does she do that? I wonder. What's this? A staple. So that's how she keeps her looks. Must be 10 years of loose skin behind there. Stand by, Joanie. I'm a coming in. Well, here we are, next to Joanie's heart. You see, she has got one after all. Don't you feel dreadful, all those terrible things you've said about her? In real life, she's not the least bit like the way she's portrayed on film. Hang on, what's that? The heart speeded up. Oh no! Bungalow Bill's arrived! Oh, I've got to get out of here. I know. I'll go through her mouth. Oh no! They're kissing! Oh, there's no way out. I'd better head south. Oh, trapped! Stop!
perverted parades of crude smutteries? But a 14-year-old schoolboy could do better. I knew I could do it better when I was a 14-year-old schoolboy and have somewhere to hang my satchel. In future, I order of the campaign for nice things on television. During scenes of explicit lusting warmery, this special triangle will appear on your screens. In front of me, you fools!
We are children of the world, watching every day go by.
Changes my life, changes your life.
Keeps us all anticipating. We are searchers of the truth. Every man's a boy deep down.
Gotta say it how you mean it.
Yes, you've guessed it. It's the world-famous Bee Gees, who have sold more records than any other group called the Bee Gees in the entire history of the world. And as you know, the boys very seldom give interviews. But they're here tonight to answer all the in-depth questions that you at home don't give a damn about. Well, guys, you're in the middle of a world tour and have just finished sell-out concerts here in London. Why is it, do you think, that millions of people love your music?
'Cause we're living in a world of fools.
I see. Some people have implied that your high voices, coupled with the long hair, shirt open to the navel, revealing hairy chest and medallion look, suggest that you're somewhat less than masculine, and that you...
Look the other way!
Exactly. What do you say to that?
Ha, 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 ha!
I see. So you poo-poo the less than masculine slur, do you, Barry?
Well, you can't tell by the way I use my walk on the woman's man.
Yes, well, let's talk about those famous BG teeth now. How would you describe them?
Massachusetts.
I see. Massachusetts. It's a joke.
It's a tragedy.
Well, I agree.
Got to understand.
I did, but let's face it, it's a very dull joke.
We can make it shine.
Okay, I'll give you one more chance. Tell the joke again.
Massachusetts!
No, it doesn't work. Forget it. Ladies and gentlemen, I've been talking to the Bee Gees. Great. Didn't they?
All right, where is he? I know there's a man here somewhere.
No, Harry, no, there's no one else. I love only you, Harry.
Slave away at the office all day.
Harry.
While you're sitting here,
no.
Having a good time, eating chocolates,
no,
watching
Harry.
Television, painting your nails.
Please.
While you're here having fun with other men.
Oh, Harry, please don't. You know it'll only end in tears.
I know he's here somewhere. Where is he? I know somewhere in this flat there's a man. What are you doing in my wife's wardrobe?
Waiting for a bus.
Waiting for a bus? What does he think I am, a fool?
little video buffs. It is me, the enchanting Marcel. The experience of a lifetime on legs. How are you? Are you in the mood? Good. I'll be there in 20 minutes. I just have this little joquette to do. What is it that a man does standing up, a woman sitting down, and a dog on three legs? Did you get it? A man standing up, a woman sitting down, and a dog on three legs. It's shaking hands. What else could it be? I'm coming round. Pop your cork.
What?
Wanna buy a cassette? A video cassette?
Yeah, where is it?
Brown paper bag.
What is it?
Girls. Yeah. Girls dressed as nuns. Straight up geezers in boots and black leather running round in the woods.
What else?
Goats.
How much?
100 quid.
Oh, give us it, you right. Beauty.
Hello, Muriel Cleveland here for the campaign for nice things on television. We believe in goodness, truth, and beauty. We think that Julie Andrews should get her own series and Joan Collins should get her own breakfast. And remember, you don't have to watch this endless display of perversitude and fleshy bollery. You've all got a knob there, so use it!
That's lovely true, Michael. I just got back from the Cannes Film Festival. You know, Michael, you know, I never thought I'd make it in this business, but I have. You know, everybody was so friendly. I mean, I was talking to all the big directors. They'd come up to my room, and we'd have some drinks, and then they'd put it to me. So exciting to know I'm really wanted by big people. And so many times. The phone never stopped. The word must have got around that was a certainty for stardom. You know, these directors, they don't really talk about films. They just want to get into you as a person. Anyway, I hope you'll all go and see my new movie, Bloodbath of the Naked Vixens. It's all done in the best possible taste.
All plugged up. Is your nose Gilbert City? Try Nasofloss for that instant relief. Nasofloss.
Miss Lovett, could you come in for a moment, please? Something's just come up.
In case you want to do some dictation as well.
Hi, Miss Lovett. Would you come over here, please? There's something I want you to take down.
Yes, it is a bit hot in here, isn't it? Now, what can I do for you?
Well, there's a couple of things I need to handle.
I mean, you take something down?
Well, there's several letters, yes.
You want to give me one now?
Yeah, well, I think we should do the letters first, don't you?
You are naughty.
Boy, you're gonna hold it against me.
Could we stop the sketch, please? It's gone far enough.
What?
It's degrading to women, insulting to the intelligence, smutty and chauvinistic.
Here, who are you to walk in the middle of this fantastic sketch? What's going on here?
I am Mary Hinge from the BBC Standards Department, and I will not have you lowering them. You come on here with this overdeveloped tart, whose only function, as far as I can see, is to act as the butt for your pathetic single entendre gutter remarks. Now, that may have been good enough for the other side, but may I remind you that it's the BBC, and we won't stand for this lowest common denominator, barrel-scraping, filth-ridden, moronic so-called humour, which has no intellectual content whatsoever and relies solely on the degradation of women, portraying them as sexual objects and seemingly based on the assumption that anything to do with overdeveloped breasts is funny!
You're only saying that because you ain't got any.
What's this? Scotch mist?
Point those fried eggs at me.
Please, please, this is the BBC.
What do I do?
Oh, don't say things like that. Can't you see she's upset?
I'm sorry, I didn't know. I didn't want to come over me.
It's all right, love. Don't worry.
I was only trying to do my job.
I know, I know.
That's so small.
Well, actually, I'm
do you really?
Yeah, you should be proud of your body. After all, you're a woman.
Am I?
Oh, Margot. I bet if you took those glasses off and,
yes,
and maybe let that hair down, you could be a star.
Think I'll make it in show business?
You're fantastic, actually.
These clothes will have to go, won't they? Anything you've got coming off, you want me to take down and held against you, Mr. Rathbone?
Anything you like, Miss Hinge, but let's get something straight between us first. This sketch is degrading to men.
Get off, you flat-chested pig.
Do you mind? This is an internal call.
The imagination as a Kenny Everett fan. How can I put it? I just can't stand the little creep.
Well, what did you think, Janet?
Oh, I can't stand him either. And when you say that show, I hear that awful Pamela Stevenson portrayed me as some sort of gibbering loon. Bloody terrible.
I know, it wasn't at all like me.
I mean, who do I think I am? Mark Yarwood.
Mark Yarwood? I can't stand him. The curly hair.
Right.
Does give us a clue.
No, that's Michael Aspel. Can't stand him.
No, neither can I. Well, which one's Kenny Everett then?
Oh, you know, the broken down disc jockey with a beard.
That's Noel Edmonds. Can't stand him.
No, not Noel Edmonds. Kenny Everett.
Which one's he then? Oh, no. He does the morning show on Radio 2. Never stops bleeding talking. Can't stand him.
No, that's Terry Wogan.
Well, which one's Kenny Everett?
You know, the one that does a Janet Straight Porter impression with our awful Pamela Stevenson.
Can't stand her.
Thank you.
speaking very quietly because I don't want to disturb one of the most rare and threatened of our native species, the three-toed Jimbongi. Indeed, so rare are these funny little creatures that none has been sighted for years. But recently, the discovery of a small colony of three-toed Jimbongis was made. Right here, somewhere in this meadow. These armadillo-like creatures have the most astonishingly effective camouflage. There are thought to be but a few of these strange creatures left now, and their population is dwindling all the time. What has caused this sudden decline? Some say it is habitat. Others have it that their source of food has simply dried up. I, however, have my own theory. I believe that not enough has been done by the powers that be to stop the territory of these charming animals being invaded by tourists. Tell me, the sort of people who simply don't understand that these creatures just need to be left alone.
Cut!
Is that okay?
Sorry, lovey. Can we do it again? We're picking up something very strange on sound.
Special effects.
It was me all the time.
You're just wait. You should be more careful, Michael. You're overdoing it.
Whatever it is you do.
Personally, I don't like diets. Oh, I'm carrying a few extra pounds here and there. But they're balanced, you know what I mean? Believe me, Michael, fat can be fun, honey. It's on me and I'm not having it off. I'm talking about fat, Michael. Cuts. Anyway, what I really wanted to talk about is my new picture. Have you seen E.T.? Isn't it wonderful? We're doing the sequel. It's called T.I.T. Stands for Terrestrial in Torment. It's gonna be a big one, Michael, and this time, no mistakes. So many times in the past, I've had the big one and blew it. Know what I mean? Rhoda, it's all about this cute little spaceman who comes to Earth and he finds his way to my house. I'm just sitting there and suddenly I see this little green thing in front of me. And he stands there talking in this strange space language. But I know what he's saying. They're all the same, Michael. They want to find their way back to their own planet, but could you put me up for the night? Heard it all before. Suddenly, the whole house starts to shake, and all my clothes fall off. And then, my chest burst open, and this thing comes running out yelling, I've seen the promised land! I'm telling you the plot, Michael. Go and see it, you'll love it. And it's all done in the best possible taste.
Who is that woman with the beard?
She's a film starlet, sir.
Oh, starlet, well, why has she got a beard? Women don't have beards. There are creams and things. You remember that trouble my wife had with her moustache?
No, Everett's got a beard, sir. That was him dressed up.
No, it was my wife. I remember her distinctly.
No, sir, it was Kenny Everett doing that sketch dressed up as a film starlet talking about her latest film. It's apparently called T.I.T.
T.I.T.? What does that mean?
Terrestrials in Torment, sir.
Oh, I see, yes. Double entendre. Now, look here, Everett. If there's one thing I will not tolerate, it is double entendre. If there's one in the show, I'm having it off. When I say I'm having it off, I mean I'm not having it. You may say I've got an obsession about double entendres. Well, I admit it. I've got a big one. I know where I stand. I stand on my scruples. Times, but we've got to hold our own and make sure it's all done in the best possible taste.
Yes, sir. Sorry, sir. Good night.
Agnes.
Yes, please.
Have you been to the chiropodist lately?
Oh, dear, I don't go anymore. No, dear, I don't go. I'm sorry. Can we start again?
Agnes.
Yes, Chris.
Agnes.
Yes, Chris.
Have you been to the chiropodist lately?
Oh, no, dear, I don't go anymore. Since, you know.
Agnes.
I'm sorry, my necklace just fell off. My shoes keep falling off.
Agnes. Sugar.
I'd like to dunk you in my coffee, spread you on my bread. Gee, I wish that you were in the highball going to my head. Dear, when you sit across the table, I'm done like the giant in the fable. Fee-fi, for fun, I'm overcome with a cannibalistic feeling. I'd like to smother you with mushrooms, and everything. I claim you'd be a dainty dish to set before a king. I could obtain you as part of my daily menu. I'd like to dunk you in my coffee, spread you on my bread. Sweetheart, if I could obtain you as part of my daily menu, I'd like to dunk you in my coffee, spread you on my bread.